So, was it Paddy's idea you want to talk a little more about books? So we like to end our events sometimes with an author keynote who can tie in the work of not just being able to read, but reading to the work that we're doing in an emotional and inspiring as well as an intellectual way.
Oh.
And we were looking for who was going to be the right keynote for this event.
No pressure.
So, like your libraries, we wear a lot of hats. And besides my primary work of professional development for librarians, I'm also the science fiction and fantasy editor. So it just so happened that when we were looking for the right keynote for this event, I saw an article on this really cool sci-fi author from Indianapolis. So I was like, I gotta click on my ad. And I don't know if you know what a full-stack developer is. It's somebody in computer science who can do six jobs. So what I found here is a full-stack author. He's a young adult and middle grade author. He's a adult science fiction and fantasy author. He's a mentor and author community builder in the community. He's a community organizer beyond just writers. And I just discovered last night at the party that in his spare time, he's also a teacher. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Maurice Broaddus. He's gonna take us out.
And I chronicle some of their elementary school antics in The Usual Suspects. I mean, The Usual Suspects is basically kind of like a love letter to my children. But I hope you heard that last part. It's their elementary school antics. So when I turned in the draft to my editor, she was just like, this doesn't seem very believable as stuff that middle school students might be into. And I'm like, well, one, when they were in fifth grade, that's what I thought too. And two, maybe I'll spend more time with middle school students. Because they're sort of like people. Now, I am fully cognizant of what I'm raising. I'm aware. My oldest son, the way I like to describe him is he likes to learn systems, right? He likes to learn the rules, figure out the ins and outs, and then he figures out how to finesse that system to his advantage. My youngest son does not care about your systems. Now he lives to test, to ignore, and to break systems. And he goes through the world on his own terms. And knowing this, and knowing this about my sons, you know, I decided pretty early on in my career that maybe I ought to shadow my sons through the school system. As a substitute teacher, you know, one to be there to support them, also to back up the teachers and the administration. And as an aside, I firmly believe all parents should spend time in a classroom, if only to see what their little angel is up to with their friends during the school day, and see what the teacher has to deal with in terms of wrangling in class. And, you know, because everyone is ready to criticize teachers, until they are staring down a classroom. Like they're that lone gazelle that just wandered into a blind family. Right? So anyway, my boys ended up at the Oaks Academy Middle School. And again, my youngest son put the school through its paces. His opening salvo, he changed the password accounts on several teachers' accounts. He tried to set the record for the number of office visits and in-school suspensions. Because if nothing else, I raised goal-oriented students. But he also accidentally set in motion this complicated scheme that resulted in a police investigation. Where halfway being interviewed, that's me and him sitting across the desk from these two detectives, and halfway through this interview, he leans over to me and goes, "Hey Dad, gotta give you an idea for a sequel to your next book." I told him, son, A, didn't need your help. And B, this is so gonna be a sequel. This is so gonna be a sequel. Which obviously left two very confused detectives at that point. Although this kid, at one point, we're still in this interview, and you know we're trying to mount this defense. Everything turned out fine. I'll skip ahead. Everything turned out fine. But at one point, he goes like, he says something like 6947, and I'm like 6947. What are you talking about? And suddenly the detective goes, "Wait, that's the passcode to my cell phone. How'd you get that?" I'm like, "Oh, damn! Can you not do this right now? This is really not helping our case." So you know. Anyway, the situation turned out fine, and like I said, but it did give me a great opportunity to begin an ongoing conversation with my son that perhaps his way isn't working, and he may want to look at making a few adjustments on how he moves through the world. But after walking him, the detectives, the families involved, and the school through this situation, you know, I got called to the principal's office. And I don't care how old you are. Right? I don't care how old you are. You never get over that anxious feeling of sitting outside the principal's door, waiting to be called in. And don't get me wrong, I've known our principal for like over 10 years. We've been friends long outside the school system, but not in that moment. In that moment, she's the principal. And I'm sitting there, reverting back to being a middle school student, and I'm preparing my, what had happened was story. But she sits me down, and she says, "Hey, you know what? The way you handled that situation was amazing. Have you ever thought about being a teacher?" Well, truth be told, I had. You know, it hadn't been my dream growing up as a kid. When I was a kid, I actually wanted to be a scientist and a writer. And by this time, I had spent 20 years as a scientist, and about 10 years as a professional writer at this point. But being in a classroom, working with kids, that woke something in me. And when I confessed this, she got this look in her eye. This very strange look in her eye. And it made me kind of scared. I'm like, all right, what'd I say? And then she leans across and goes, "Black male students are like unicorns. I mean, black male teachers are like unicorns." And I didn't know that at the time, but black male teachers, they only made up less than 2% of all teachers. And black students could go their entire school careers and not ever encounter one. And now, don't get me wrong, as a school, we're not where we want to be in terms of representation. But as I look back over my own school career, I didn't encounter my first black male teacher until I was in high school. I mean, the biology teacher, his name is Mr. Broaddus, no relation. And he was a biology teacher. And I went on to get my degree in biology. And that's how I became, that's the story of how I became an accidental teacher. When I was 6 years old, my family moved to this country from England. So basically I was gone from London, England, to this thriving metropolis known as Franklin, Indiana. And trust me, even if you're from Indiana, you're gonna have trouble finding Franklin, Indiana on the map. And so they had trouble placing me in the school system. They went ahead and skipped me up a grade, skipped me up to like second grade, and probably knew I should have been in third, but they were considering all the social ramifications of me being so much younger than everyone else in the class. But seeing how bored I was, my second grade teacher, Mrs. Rainey, and it's amazing how you always remember the teachers that touched your life, Mrs. Rainey, my second grade teacher, she sent me in the back of the room with a stack of blank paper and just said, "You know what, just go ahead and create stuff. Let me tell you." And I thought American school systems were awesome. So I created little books, You know, I filled them with stories and poems and prayers, and I was writing. And I was learning to the love of writing. And what Mrs. Rainey may not have realized is what she was doing, she allowed me room to dream about possibilities. Let me repeat that. She allowed me room to dream. I was blessed. And I didn't know how blessed I was until later. See, we moved up to Indianapolis a couple years later, and I was placed in what was called the enrichment program. And my brother, who was only a year younger, he wasn't. So we ended up in two different schools. And after his fifth grade year, his school performance, I mean, nosedived. And at the time, we figured, oh, well, he just hates school. But then my cousin and his family moved up here from Jamaica, and the same thing happened. He had the same fifth grade teacher as my brother, and then his school performance nosedived. Turned out that his teacher had, and we'll be generous, and we call it an unconscious bias against younger black males. She gave up on him pretty early. You know, writing him off as troublemakers, not interested in learning, you know, disruptors. And essentially started creating self-fulfilling prophecies. So one bad teacher derailed, we don't know how many young black students with a label and a bias. Now my brother, he managed to recover after high school when he joined the Marines. My cousin, however, became an unfortunate statistic. So I think back on this idea of being a unicorn and how the presence of a single black male teacher in their early years might have course corrected them. Even just the power of presence as a model. I see my students, they have the luxury of seeing me and the other black males and teachers in their school. So they can take me for granted, they can do imitations of my walk going down the hallway. You know, they got me looking like George Jefferson or something struck down the halls. So. God bless you for getting that reference. I was worried about that one. So in high school, I developed my love of libraries. Now, rather than telling you about my high school experiences, I'll tell you about this novel that I wrote. And you have to keep in mind, I write for me, right? So I have several books that I've written that have never bothered me to get published. I write them, you know, for me. I have things I have to say, I have things I'm feeling, I just want to get them out. Whether they get published, that's another consideration. But this one's called The Lost Creole. And it's about this kid in high school who has so much trouble with his bullies that he has this kind of break with reality, and now he's narrating his life as if he's a wizard in training in a Tolkien-like fantasy novel. And as an aside, this is a ridiculous premise. The reality was, in my junior year, I had a break with reality and decided I was actually Batman. I made all my friends call me the Dark Knight. It was a thing. At my 20-year reunion, I bumped into some of my bullies, and as it turned out, they kind of confessed that apparently I had gotten so weird, they decided to just leave me alone. I mentioned this ridiculous premise to some of my colleagues, and they were like, yeah, that's ridiculous. We have three Harry Potters in our classroom right now. Okay. So anyway, this wizard from training, he could only find escape and solace in this safe haven called the library. Now, it was a 30-minute walk to the neighborhood library from the high school. That's a trek that my character made every day, along with some of his friends, to hang out, to study, to just be. You see, the library was this magical place that had all these portals called books. And they took me my character, to new worlds. And it's where he was able to learn new things and practice his craft because he was also developing his skills as a storyteller. The library became a place that allowed him the space to dream. So now, to be fair, I'm also an accidental librarian. So I went back and I'm a substitute teacher, our school librarian, went on maternity leave. And they asked me to sub for her because hello, writer. And I love books. But when she finished her maternity leave, she transferred back to the lower school, and I've been the school librarian ever since. Now, this is a journey. Now, if you ask my wife, I was born to be a librarian because I archive everything. In fact, I still have all the notes that I passed in high school, sorted by year. And thank you for laughing. I'm thinking I'm really strange at this point. Now, see, smart writers love libraries and librarians because they know stories and they know books. So people ask me, ask me often about some of the secrets to my writing career. And, you know, for one thing, when I'm stuck, I turn to libraries and librarians. I was on a panel at ALA a couple years ago promoting my urban fantasy series, Knights of Greenport, and they asked me what I was thinking about writing next. You know, and I mentioned I was thinking about turning my short story, I had a steampunk short story called Pimp My Airship. I was thinking about turning it into a novel, and they nodded, and I go, okay, yeah, that sounds interesting. And I said, well, I do have this other idea, but, you know, it's about two young black boys as detectives in their school. My whole audience woke up as quiet as you are right now. And they leaned forward, and one of the librarians yelled out, tell us more. And that was all I needed to convince me that maybe I ought to write this book. So I went ahead and wrote The Usual Suspects. Now, I was still planning on writing Pimp My Airship the novel, but I got stuck with some of the world building. You know, I wanted to set this novel in like turn of the century Indianapolis with all that with beautiful architecture and have the stream of history rolling through it, but I kind of stuck. And so I turned to a librarian. Librarians who, as you know, professional researchers who get far too excited when someone's looking for information. So they directed me to all these arcane books and microfiche and warehouses full of photos and maps. And I get that at this point I'm starting to sound like that guy in the bar who spills all of his problems to his bartender, except in this case the bartender really loves books. But I got to a point in my career actually that I was kind of stuck. I knew I had to go to start going to conferences, you know, for professional development, but I didn't have any money. And again, I poured out my problems to a librarian. And she was like, hey, have you considered grants? Grants? For writers? What'd you get? All she needed to hear. Then all of a sudden, I'm taking through all these grant workshops and showing all these databases and all these other resources. So I consider it my absolute privilege to be considered a librarian. At school, at the OSCAM, I manage the shared systems program. And although the bulk of my system, the bulk of my job actually tends to be this, I don't know, this recurring conversation I keep having over and over and over again with my students. You know, they come up to me and it's like, I said, so let me get this straight. I can order a book from any computer, and it'll be delivered to the school. I pick that book up from you, and you check it out for me. Yeah. And as long as you return the book to the school, there aren't any late fees. It's that simple. Yeah. It's that simple. You know, because back in my day, no, Mr. Broaddus. You're trying to run game on me. So let's go over this one more time. Way was a perfect imitation of my student Elijah. You might not appreciate that, but that's spot on impersonation. All because middle schoolers, obviously, aren't the most trusting of folks. They're kind of my people. Now, my teachers, however, I had to tell them this once. And I even got to explain that, you know, they could have an additional library card, you know, for their classroom, just so they can order extra books with extended loan period times. And just this week, my good friend and art teacher ordered 47 art books for a project. 47 art books. For those not experienced, art books are not light. And my room is on the third floor. And he reminded me just how much I really, really love my job. So before I became an accidental teacher and an accidental librarian, I was and am a writer. And because of my faith background, I've always kind of wrestled with this idea of how do we make the world a better place? And I struggled with how to do this because, you know, I think to myself, you know, I'm just a writer. Well, I fell in with a few community groups, and one of which is called the Kepler Institute. And they're a grassroots organization, and they believe in community empowerment through self-mastery. Basically, they train up young people to become community leaders. And this organization actually started when some young men in the neighborhood were struggling in the school system. You know, these were some men who some of the teachers had given up on, had labeled. And here's the thing, with the usual suspects, I mean, it's all about kids who've been labeled by a system, who most of whom are, you know, smart and bored, and now have to navigate life within the confines of this label. Well, these young men were supported by the Kepler Institute with tutoring, and they were given entrepreneurial experience opportunities. And then from there, from this handful of, I think it was five young men at the time, the Kepler Institute has grown to work with hundreds of people who live in the community. And Ken describes what they do as people-centered work. building authentic relationships with people, not grounded in any sort of transactional outcome, not focused on an agenda, but hearing and seeing the person in front of them, learning about them, caring about them, supporting them. They believe that's how you build strong communities. It sounds a lot like what we do as educators, right? At the Oaks Academy, we talk about embracing the possibilities of our students, seeing them through the eyes of who they could be, because the potential of every child exceeds our ability to measure. We all need to be about the business of doing people-centered work. One of the first talks I gave at KI was the history of African-American in Broaddus speculative fiction, because we've been doing this for a while. Not too many people know this, but even W.E.B. Du Bois wrote science fiction, right? In fact, one of my fellow authors, Tanana Duke, she says that even the act of imagining ourselves with a future is an act of resistance. So this led to us doing a series of record conversation series called Afrofuture Fridays, and us building an Afrofuturism library within the community as a set of resources for people to peruse and use it as they see. For those who don't know, Afrofuturism is art. It's become real popular ever since Black Panther hit. But Afrofuturism is art seen through the Black cultural lens. So basically, it's an art practice rooted in the past that critiques the present and creates roadmaps to the future. Because, you know, we live in dark days. I mean, not quite post-apocalyptic, where, you know, I'm more most comfortable writing. But times are rough. And the work is hard. And our Afrofuturism series has become more critical to our work in ways I hadn't even imagined. Because sometimes we get so caught up in surviving today, we lose sight of the fact that part of what we're to be about is creating the future we want to see. In other words, these stories, this Afrofuturist art, allows the community the space to dream of what a better tomorrow could look like. I was the first person in my family to go to college, and I knew I wanted to be a writer. And my mother, also known as the person paying for everything, said that she was not going to pay for me being a writer. She wanted me to major in something, in her words, respectable. And by respectable, she meant going to nursing. Because by strange coincidence, my mom was a nurse. So I told her, okay, told is a strong word. My mother is Jamaican, and you don't even tell Jamaican women that anything. But I'll go with tell because this is my story. We're all the heroes in our own stories. So I told my mom. Okay, I reminded my mom. I reminded my mom that I daydream a lot. And not to put too fine a point on it, but if people's lives are in my hand, folks are going to die. So we compromised, and that's what led to me being a biology major. Again, as an aside, not quite satisfied with this, my mother became the second person in our family to go to college. Completed her nursing degree, and then later when my sisters went on to become a nurse, that made me completely off the hook. So, but I want to go back and think about this idea of me being a professional daydreamer. You know, I'm reminded of my friend, Russell Palmer, who I work alongside over at Keller. And he had so many labels on him at the time. He actually wasn't in school. We met at the African Americans in Speculative Fiction Writing talk, and for matters of full disclosure, he didn't want to attend, but some of the elders in the space encouraged him to go. Now, he had my full attention the entire time that I was talking, because you know when you have an engaged student, right? And it turns out that talk woke something in him. As a writer, as a gamer, and as a daydreamer. And I'm not gonna lie, his head is always in the clouds. You know, half the time we're not even sure if he's with us on this planet or even in this timeline. And you know what? Good. Daydreaming is a valuable skill set. It's one to be nurtured. And he's now in his second year of college and has grown to be one of the major strategic thinkers for the organization. All because he's been known, loved, and supported while given room to dream. Dreaming about possibilities for himself, for the organization, for the community. So as I conclude, earlier this week my wife came up to me, she had her cell phone in her hand, and she's been struggling, admittedly, because her oldest is off in this foreign land known as Ball State University. And so she has to check in with him regularly. And this time she has a weird look on her face. And turns out she's just received this text. Our son has discovered and is making a big deal of this place he's discovered called the library. And did you know, because he was stunned to realize this, that he and his friends could gather there and study. As for my youngest, I'm not worried about him finding his way either. He's only a junior in high school. He's not supposed to have everything figured out. You know, and I continue to encourage him to try things and to fail at things. To take what he's learned and try, and perhaps fail at new things. And as we say at Kepler, fail stands for first attempts in learning, and sometimes you need many first attempts. And as parents, we love, we know, and we support. Walking alongside our children in their journeys. And all he needs is the freedom to dream about who he wants to be. And I know he will figure it out. But what we have assembled in this room, creatives, teachers, librarians, administrators, we have the opportunity to create space for people to dream. We create and hold that container. As a librarian, as a writer, as a teacher, I'm cognizant of the fact that we have a sacred responsibility. And because I'm a writer, I choose my words carefully. So let me repeat that. We have a sacred responsibility. As writers, we are the creators of stories. As librarians, we are the keepers of stories. We are the cultural and institutional memory of our society. As teachers, we have the responsibility to pass those stories down. The stories that shape us as people, the stories that shape us as a culture, the stories that shape us, that shape future generations. This is how we begin to create the future we want to see, together, to help make the world a better place. Thank you.
Thank you. That was just fabulous. I appreciate it. I think Meredith pushed out an article we just did on Afrofuturism on Twitter, so thank you for raising that up.
Okay.
So, thank you, everyone.